Hello, everybody, and welcome to an Out on That Line very special episode. I don't know what we're going to call this, but with me, once again, you may recognize him from our Coheed and Cambria deep dive or our Behind the Music special feature. Friend of the show, Tanner. Tanner, how you doing?
I'm excellent. How are you doing?
I am well, thank you. Thank you for joining us on this momentous day.
Oh, a pleasure, a pleasure.
What is it that we're doing here today?
Today we're going to talk about Elvis Costello.
You know this.
And our guy, who Alex and I both love tremendously, came out with a new album, The Boy Named If. And we just want to talk most things Costello. Maybe not all things Costello, but...
This is by no means a comprehensive conversation,
yeah, yeah.
I think, for two admitted superfans.
Correct.
It's a good introduction for those of you who maybe don't know Elvis Costello, or if you're like Jeff, are a fucking dyed-in-the-wool hater.
We see you, Jeff.
Yeah, that's why we're doing
that's
this.
That's why we're here.
Because if I had suggested this to Jeff, he would have driven to my house and shot me. I want to ask you, what was your introduction to Elvis Costello?
So, I mean, I had always known the name Elvis Costello. My mom was always a fan when I was, like, you know, way younger. I don't recall any songs from when I was a kid, though. Nothing like the Steely Dan connections that we talk about. But I remember that you got really into him. I had known the song Allison for a while, and then you were like, hey, like, you should check out My Aim Is True. So, the beauty of Spotify, right? Hopped on there. You know, this is several years ago. And then, pretty into it. Wound up at a Bull Moose coming back from Maine. Maybe I was, like, seeing a concert up in Portland or something like that. And was looking for My Aim Is True on cassette. They had on a CD rather. They had it, and I was like, "Well, what else do they have from this guy?" And they had Spike, and they had Punch the Clock.
Damn.
Yeah. So I just grabbed everything that they had, and admittedly, I didn't listen to Spike for a while. And when I did, it wasn't quite what I was getting used to with Costello, because Punch the Clock is you know, it's so peppy, it's so full of horns and everything, and then you go to something like Spike. Which is way more, you know, singer-songwritery, acoustic, and like maybe I just wasn't in the right maybe mindset at that point. Mm-hmm. But no, Punch the Clock and My Aim Is True are the two first ones that like really, really got me in Elvis Costello.
He loves to dabble in all these different genres because it's a different way of reaching a whole new audience with what he's trying to say. And I think sometimes it works. I think Almost Blue worked very well. Mm-hmm. I think that Punch the Clock was a little bit different. All of his albums have like a very distinct identity.
This is what his album, and then we're going to out ourselves here, 33rd album, 32nd album?
32nd.
32nd album. So, I mean, he's put out a lot of stuff, and I don't think anybody can put out 32 albums of all great songs. We're not trying to sit here and say that he's been able to do that. We're sitting here and saying that sometimes he misses. And but with this one, The Boy Named If, we've determined that he did not miss. And that is, again, why we're here.
Exactly. I would call it a return to form after his last two albums. Because to me, Look Now was like an old man's album. Like when
yes.
you hear him talk about it, he's like, I wanted something with swagger. And I'm like, there's nothing swag about that album. It's pretty much like a very boomer album.
It's very lounge music-y, you know what I mean?
Yes.
Which and again, I like tracks off that album.
Me too.
But it's very lounge music-y.
Yeah. What about your favorite albums? Three favorite albums.
Okay. I mean, I knew this was coming. It's difficult, but I've got to say that Trust is my favorite album from Elvis Costello, and then King of America at number two. And then number three would have to be Imperial Bedroom.
Damn.
I think, you know, you limit it to three. And I love Punch the Clock, but if I'm only getting, you know, three, it's got to be Imperial Bedroom at number three.
And Trust is number one. Why is Trust number one for you?
Trust, it just makes sense to me. I have a hard time describing just how much Trust makes sense to me. Also, the kind of the mystery behind it's really cool, where you're like, all these songs have like these brooding lyrics, and he's like, yeah, I don't remember any of it. We were just, you know, wasted the whole time. Yeah. And it's back in the era where he was putting out basically an album a year.
My top three are Punch the Clock.
Okay.
Is probably my favorite because that was a big New York City. I don't know if you guys know this, but I used to live in New York City.
You lived in New York.
Uh-huh. So anyway, that was a bit like, it's scary as shit when you move there. for like the first 2 weeks, you're like, so of course I'm riding on trains and buses, a little country bumpkin, and I'm like, I need something to kind of ground me here. And Punch the Clock became that album, and it became synonymous with a lot of walks through Brooklyn and just kind of taking in the new surroundings. So that album is burned on the surface of my heart. It's probably my favorite just because of what that experience was like for me. I carried that with me. And the times where there were two footprints in the sand, Elvis Costello was walking with me. But when there was only one set of footprints, it was Elvis carrying me. My second one is Trust. And my third is Spike.
Yes. Okay.
Spike shot up the rankings for me. Like, obviously, Love, Imperial Bedroom, that was tough. Armed Forces was another big New York one for me.
Yeah.
But Spike, Spike is just such a hidden gem. I guess we got to address the elephant in the room, which is Hey Clock Face.
Don't want to talk about this.
We have to in order to heal. There are just so many problems with that album. It was like, okay, if Look Now was like an old man kind of not realizing he's an old man, someone in between Look Now and Hey Clock Face went, you sound old as fuck, dude. You got to pull something out. And he goes, well, I know what kids love. Tin Pan Alley.
And Spoken Word.
Because his voice was shot.
Yep.
To wit.
Oh, no.
When we went to see him at the Flynn, he came out to sing Shot with His Own Gun. And from Jump Street, he was off key. And
a song that's just him and Steve Naive on the grand piano. There's no other accompaniment.
There was nothing he could do. And he, to his credit, never panicked.
No, he's a professional.
He just stayed locked in, but he was so committed to being in the wrong key. So it's like the original key is da-na-na-na-na-na. Like, he was almost like 2.5 steps up from where he should have been. Shot with his own gun. We're like, no, just, Elvis.
Yeah. We white-knuckled that one.
White-knuckles like on black.
Another great song off of Trust.
Do you want to kick us off on this album, what your kind of overall impressions were?
Yeah, yeah. Well, the first single came out, Magnificent Hurt, and we listened to it together, and his voice was, like, really loud in the mix, I remember. And so I was like, but it's, like, better than anything off of, you know, Fuckface album. Second single comes out, Paint the Red Rose Blue, which I'm sure we're going to talk about in length later. And then I think a third one had come out, Penelope Halfpenny, maybe? I'm not sure. I didn't listen to the third single when it came out. I wanted to wait for the album.
Yeah, I think it was Penelope Halfpenny. I also did not listen to it.
Yeah, so album comes out, Toss It On, and it's just as if he, like, had heard all the shit that we talked about Clockface and just like reverted right back to his old stuff. And we're not talking about just like derivative rehashing of his old material, because as this album goes, there's pieces of a ton of his different albums,
yes,
song by song.
Mm-hmm.
There are songs on this album that you could pick up and drop into any of his older albums, which I think is a massive credit to him as a songwriter after putting out an absolute dump truck hate fuck of an album.
Stoke's dinner. What a shame.
So it's just, it's a great return to form on many fronts for Elvis Costello. And the Imposters, the band really fucking shells out on this album. Not to say that they don't usually. Pete Thomas, one of my drumming idols, and another reason why Trust is a huge favorite album of mine is his drumming on that album is tremendous. You got Davey Farriger playing bass now. If
he's
you're
back,
Office
baby.
Fans out there, he's the bass player in Kevin's band at Phyllis and Bob Vance's wedding. So
I did not know that.
Yeah, he's the bass player in Kevin's police band. So take a big bite of that one.
Yeah.
You pop culture snobs. And then Steve Naive on keys. And
as
I heard
good as he's ever been.
I heard an interview where Elvis was saying, like, this was supposed to be a guitar album. I had written all these songs to be big guitar albums. And then, like, they did, like, a live stream kind of band practice thing because Steve Naive lives in Paris. And, like, we heard what Steve was doing, and we were like, nope, we're doing that. We are doing that.
I just think it's cool in the context of Look Now and Hey Clockface, because, like I said, Look Now was an old man who doesn't realize he's an old man.
Yes.
Hey Clockface is an old man who overcorrected. And Boy Named If is a reckoning with that whole mentality. You're not a young man anymore. You've had a lot of experiences. The whole idea of if What could I have done differently? What if I had done this? What if I do this? It's a lot of questions being asked on this album. It's a really existential album. It's a young man's album.
Yes,
he's got that spirit because he's walking through those memories. It's like he becomes Elvis Costello classic while he's kind of working out all of these thoughts and feelings. And I think like that is what made this such a revelation for me. I'm like, oh, he's not back. He never left. Well, do you want to kick us off?
Yeah. So the album opens with the song Farewell Okay. And it just fires right in. There is no, some albums open with like little intro tracks. Some albums, you know, might build into the first song. This song comes right out. It hits you in the face. It's very blood and chocolatey.
Sure.
And that's no more apparent than it is in the bass line that Davey plays. And he just moves it. Like, he is the driving force of that song. And he sits so well in the mix.
And for me, you mentioned blood and chocolate. I got a lot of this year's model out of that.
Mm-hmm.
Especially in our old pal Steve Nighy with the organ. As soon as he laid it in, I was like, oh my God. And also, Uncle Elvis's voice is back.
Yes.
He sounded younger, too, man.
He sounds younger than he does on Look Now.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Oh, yeah. Like,
he sounds young. They're in the pocket. And again, it just puts you right on your way
for
what this album's going to be. Like, you get a real good indication of what's in store by this opening track, Farewell Okay.
The boy named If. That insanely industrial clang that kind of starts it, that heavy stomping footstep, that was something that coincidentally Muse did on Won't Stand Down.
Mm-hmm.
Where I was like, oh, it's got this very, like, obviously Elvis Costello is not doing dubstep, but it kind of has that, like, fat walk to it, that fat stomp. So I heard this, and I was like, okay, is he going to make up for where he whiffed with No Flag on the last album and, like, make a kind of, like, industrial punk type thing? The chorus is where it all changes, and it is so expertly done. Mm-hmm. Just the way that it just builds up. Imagine that.
I have tremendous and satisfying build to the chorus.
Oh my God,
yeah,
dude.
Yeah.
It's so, so good.
Yep.
And yeah, it's just the bridge is pure Costello. Take my hand.
We'll go to Magic Lantern Land. I have that written here. My favorite lyric off the whole album is that one. And they do the thing at the end. We were talking about this before off air, where at the very end of the song, there's like a Leslie just kind of humming. And if you listen to it with headphones on, it like starts in your left ear and then it passes through to your right ear. And then it like passes back to your left ear and then fades out. And little stuff like that, I really, really enjoy. But to put that at the end of this, like this song, it's a little bit of a slower pace, but it rips. And again, like you said, that build and that bridge. And it's very like, you know, Magic Lantern Land, Club Land.
Mm-hmm.
You can just kind of visualize these places in your head. You know, he's doing nothing to describe the place by other than saying Magic Lantern Land.
And it's the quality of the song that kind of create. He loves to create these little like pocket dimensions in his music. And that's, again, one of the things I love is that more than a lot of artists, he can take you to a time and place and like your brain fills in the visuals for you. Based off the quality of the song, like the sound of it. I see like entire music videos when I listen to a lot of his songs. I would also like to shout out, I don't know if he pronounces it Chris or Crease, but Sebastian, I'm going to go with Crease, Sebastian Crease, who mixed this.
Yes.
The mix is perfect. So A+ for you, 10 out of 10, 5 gold stars.
Thank you. The last note I have on Boy Named If is Pete Thomas, the way he just kind of sits in the pocket doing his little snare drum rolls. Again, this is just a song where every instrument is complementing Elvis's voice, and Elvis's voice is in turn complementing every instrument.
Yeah, it's perfection. So we then have the third single released, Penelope Halfpenny. And in their boxes and lock their jeans, while others get hands on nylon. Penelope, Penelope, Penelope. my initial thought was, this is a lot like Veronica off Spike. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. I mean, even Penelope, mm-hmm. Penelope, hey, Penny. It's like, okay, welcome mm-hmm. back to 1991. it's got a lot of that like punk noise over the top of a very classic sound. And once again, it's all the Steve Naive you can handle. Fill your pockets up.
I noticed that Pete Thomas plays the first half of the verse without even using his hi-hat, which is just great Pete Thomas stuff. He does that in a lot of songs. Strict Time comes to mind. Mm-hmm. I had that this feels Trust era to me based on the way that Pete Thomas is playing the drums. And at the end, like that kind of musical interlude slash outro, that really gives, again, Davey Farriger a really nice spot to shine. And he just plays some great, great bass. And if you've ever seen him play bass, you know that he just like does it with a smile. Like it's just like you can just visualize him playing these bass tracks. So that's just a nice little piece for the people that like Davey like us.
My last note was actually, do not ever sleep on Davey.
Yes, yes, yeah.
And I will say, out of an album of 13 songs, and we talked about like maybe three that don't hit, Penelope Haypenny's one for me. It's not a clunker, but it was not one of my favorites. Turn the red rose, paint the red rose blue. What was he to do but turn the red rose?
It's like a perfect centerpiece song on the album. You know, it comes in after that lull. It swoops in. I'm doing hand stuff, even though the camera can't see it. This song has an intangible quality to it.
It's a good way to put it. It's like pure emotion. It's mm-hmm. the dissolution of a relationship. It's definitely one of those from the perspective of the older man, I think. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And it's, you know, you're young and it's exciting to the romantic chase. You meet someone who really sparks you and you get together. And then it's like, at what point do you run out of surprises? And how important is that? And it feels like that's important to Elvis Costello in this context, because if he's not moving, then he's thinking. And mm-hmm. if he's thinking, then he's fucking up his entire life. Mm-hmm. So it's very much the motif for this song. It's got that same ballad quality as Satellite off Spike. I fucking love Satellite. That's one of those hits off Spike that's like, oh, mm-hmm. okay. That like kind of burned it into my heart.
Steve Naive with some great organ hooks. And Elvis Costello reaches into his bag of tricks like he usually does, and his self-harmonies, when Elvis harmonizes yeah. with himself, they're absolutely gorgeous on the chorus. It's just a nice little cherry on top of the musical sundae that him and the Impostors are serving up. This is a song that I will listen to. This is going on playlists. This, you know what I mean? I'm not going to have to listen to five songs or however many it is until it gets in there. You know what I mean? Like, yeah. This is a song that you pluck off the album. Mistook me for a friend. Mistook me for a friend.
Mistook me for a friend. Mistook me for a friend.
Yes.
What'd you think of this one?
I say that it sounds like a lot of his earlier stuff.
Yes.
He's doing this bit, spitting so many words out in verses. It's like he doesn't even get to breathe the amount of words that he is singing in these verses. I think that this drops into that, My Aim Is True to Spike. You could drop into that golden era of Costello stuff. He does like classic Costello stuff. He does the halftime feel, and the melody on the bridge, like that's a classic Costello thing that he does. And again, he drops it into this song, and you know, the syncopated, you know, blah blah blah, mistook me for a friend, like those hits, like again, that's just classic Costello stuff. And the band really shines yet mm-hmm. again on these up tempo songs. And not to say that they didn't sound good on Paint the Red Rose Blue, that's just very much like a vocal feature, you know.
Yes.
With like a little bit of Steve Naive doing stuff in the chorus, but really a vocal feature. This one is a full band feature.
It's classic Elvis Costello subject matter again, the guy who fancies yes. himself a playboy but knows he isn't. And it again, that's when he's at his most interesting, is when he's sad and he's vulnerable and he's reflective. So it's an interesting, like, this is such a, like, upbeat song, too, to kind of fit into that mold.
Yeah.
To take that subject matter. And it's that tongue-in-cheek Elvis Costello where he's like, I'm going to pretend I'm not taking this seriously, but I'm dying inside.
Yeah, yeah. This is my defense mechanism.
Yeah, I'm begging for help.
To be cynical. Yeah, upbeat and cynical. Sun did run where one hit one to this. And he says action, and that's a take. You are my most beautiful mistake.
My most beautiful mistake.
This is one that I've grown to like more the more that I hear it. I've seen your face before in courtroom sketches. That line is really good, with the female vocalist on this song. The melodies are great on the song, and yeah, like, you know, the first listen I was like, okay, you know, whatever, it's a kind of like a filler song. Second listen I was like, okay, pretty good. And then my most recent listen before we started rolling today, I was like, okay, yeah, this one is, you know. This is in the upper echelon for me for this album, I would say.
For sure, because I think it's, again, it's great subject matter because it's, well, not great.
Yeah, intriguing.
You know what I mean? It's interesting. Yeah. Because it's a Me Too fable. It's mm-hmm. It's basically Harvey Weinstein. There's all these references to the casting couch and what you'll get for what you'll give me and that kind of stuff. And I think while Elvis Costello isn't Harvey Weinstein, I think he's using a song like this, or when he uses like Mistook Me for a Friend, or going back when he does like The Difference.
Mm-hmm.
He's not the character. He's not the abusive father. He's not Weinstein. But I think he uses them to kind of parse through some of his guilt about the way he's treated women. Because he's very frank about it. He wasn't an abusive asshole, but he's kind of a fuckboy, right? Because of his insecurity.
Yeah.
So I think this is one of those songs where he's reckoning with that kind of male behavior and how he's kind of a product of his culture where it's like men don't have to respect women. Oh, excellent. It's the way you make me feel magnificent. Hurt. Magnificent. Hurt.
Yeah.
Barn Burner.
Yeah.
Take us away.
Oh, the lead single off of it, it's got prime Elvis Costello. Steve Naive is doing jingly keys. The bridge is, again, like Elvis Costello's musical DNA. Are these bridges that he writes? Like this, again, is like a This Year's Model, or like an Armed Forces, like right in that early pocket, the jingly stuff before, like he got a little heavier on the production side. But yeah, it rips. There's a really, really, really good version live that he did on like BBC Two.
Yes,
that we've watched
that's
together.
What we watched.
And it's got like a little bit of a different feel to it, which is fun. But yeah, it's just an absolute ripper.
Yeah, it's got that same kind of feel as like Boots for Moderns too. That kind of dun 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 dun, that drive. Because again, I have here circled many times bass and organ.
Mm-hmm.
It's Davey and Steve kind of really chugging this one home.
When this single came out, we have to remember that our state of mind was we were still in shell shock about how bad Clockface was. So this song comes out and like, I don't know if Paint the Red Rose Blue was the lead single. If that had come out, if we would have been like, oh my God, it's so good. Because again, we're still kind of dealing with the shell shock of how bad the last album was. So getting it in the context of this album, I think only makes it better. Now that I am so afraid to fly away from childish dreams, the death of magic thinking.
Well, then it goes right into the death of magic thinking, which A, sounds... It's so uncannily Lover's Walk. Did you get that too?
Yes. Yeah. It's like Lover's Walk, and it's like the Go-Go's, like the drum beat that the Go-Go's really kind of originated too.
Interesting.
Yeah, I had Go-Go's.
And again, the death of magic thinking continues that theme of like reckoning with who you are, who you want to be, who you hoped and feared you would become when you were younger, and just it like those questions you ask once you've accepted your mortality. That was my whole thing when we watched the Zappa documentary. I was like, I don't think it ever occurred to Frank Zappa that he was ever going to die.
Mm-hmm.
And then he was handed a death sentence.
Yeah.
And now he's thinking about all this stuff, and the tenor of his music completely changed. Present is like a man I knew. Left me standing there with nothing but you. Don't be fooled now, boys. And speaking of the end, we have Mr. Crescent.
Yes.
What'd you think of this one?
This one, not particularly one of my favorites, but I think it's an excellent choice to end the album with. I wouldn't have put this anywhere else on the album.
No.
I think it's a good closer. It kind of eases you out. The album fires you right in with Farewell OK. You hit the ground running. It's kind of nice that it kind of eases you out and sends you on your way. It's not Rager and then Rager at the end. It's almost like a reverse of, you know, other albums where it's a slow build in. And then sometimes the last song traditionally can be like, if it's like a rock album, you can get like, you know, an 8-10 minute rocker, you know, for like the last song. This is very much in the opposite vein.
Yeah. And then for me, to keep my little bullshit interpretation alive, this for me is After Death, Ghosts Now, Looking Back, because there's that line like, I wonder where Sister Honey is now.
Mm-hmm.
And it's just like kind of these thoughts, like the album fades away.
Yes.
With Elvis Costello and with these thoughts and just like, and it gradually dissipates on you.
Yeah.
And I like when albums end with a big emotional statement like that. Again, on the total opposite end of the spectrum, Phoebe Bridgers on Punisher ends with I Know the End.
Mm-hmm.
And that just goes off the fucking rails. That song, it falls apart at the seams in the best way possible. So like knowing how to open an album, knowing how to organize the tracks therein, and knowing how to end it is a real talent. It's a real skill, and not a lot of artists nail it, but it was nailed here.
Yeah, this is a great exercise in album making and not just writing songs, right? This is making an album. This is something that Costello's been able to do his entire career. There aren't many times where you're like, oh, I would have opened the album with this song. Like, right? Like, can you imagine Accidents Will Happen not opening Oliver's... what am I thinking?
Armed Forces. I almost called it Emotional Fascism. What a deep cut.
I totally had a brain fart there. But yeah, can you imagine a different song opening that?
No.
That's why
it's one of my favorite songs.
Yeah, it just swings you right in. This album is a masterclass in album making, and you ride the mountains, you ride down to the valleys, you know, it takes you on a ride, and at the very end, you know, what happens at the end of a roller coaster? You gently glide in, the air brakes hit, the lap bar comes up, and you hop off. It all kind of slowly fades away, as this album does as well.
Yeah, you just take a little moment, you sit in it,
yep,
and you get up and go on your way. We usually, at the end of the podcast, Jeff and I go, stream it or skip it.
Oh, wait, I mean, you got to stream it. I say buy it.
I would have to agree. It's worthy of your purchase, and definitely worthy of your listen. Do you have any closing remarks you'd like to get off your chest before we bail out here?
I would just like to say, if people are still watching that aren't Elvis Costello fans, I don't know why you'd still be watching, but if you are still watching, I would give something an honest listen. Give Trust an honest listen. Give Punch the Clock. Listen to Trust or Punch the Clock. There are so many artists out there, and there's so much music everywhere. For a guy that started his career way back when, to still be putting out music in this day and age is pretty cool, and it's pretty cool that we get to be along for the ride.
We should definitely do this again with a couple of our other favorites. Do some rankings, do some reviews, stuff like that.
Sweet.
All right. Well, thanks for watching, everybody, and we'll see you next time.
Bye.